Okay, now I got the first slide, so shall I start?
Yes, ma'am. Sure, we can start. We have all the participants, I think.
Okay, and you
So we'll
can see
start.
the first slide called breast sounds,
Yeah, yes,
pathological.
ma'am. Clear.
Okay,
Clear,
fine.
clear, ma'am.
Yeah, so good afternoon to all of you. Happy Republic Day to begin with. And it's nice to see postgraduates listening to a class in mid-afternoon. I think it's the best time to use because this is a time when everybody feels slightly down and sleepy. So it's good to have a preppy class at this time. And like what Sanket told, I would like to teach the concepts behind these breath sounds. And I always feel that is what is important for a postgraduate. Your most important book that you all swear by, Harrison's textbook of internal medicine. If you look at it, the cover, you will see it's called Principles of Internal Medicine. It doesn't say textbook, it says principles. So in medicine, once you understand the principles of any disease, any chapter, it is easy to go through after that. And that's the trick that we all follow when we want to remember a large amount of information. And that is what I'm going to do in this class, to teach about the principles of breath sounds so that you can apply it in any context. So the agenda for today would be to talk about normal breath sounds, the types of breath sounds, vesicular, bronchial, bronchovesicular, the intensity of breath sounds, and the adventitious sounds, which are crepitations and ronchi. Most of it will be like undergraduate level, but what the undergraduate doesn't understand but just mugs up will be explained to the postgraduate in terms of the pathology. That's what I'm going to try to do this time. Now, one of the first things that we teach any medical student is to hold the breath. But I find that even in postgraduate level, people don't know how to hold the breath. The breath should be held very firmly and should be pressed on the chest. For respiratory system examination, one doesn't lay it lightly. One always presses the skin so that you don't get a problem of what we call as skin scratch. If the patient is thin, then the skin will start moving between your breath and the patient's chest wall, and that itself will look like crepitations and pleural rub, etc. So the breath must be held firmly pressed on the skin of the patient. Preferable always to auscultate without clothes, because the shirt, the bunion or the blouse or whatever moves may cause some sound which you may mistake, and to go area by area. As we all know, most of the upper lobe areas are in anterior, the lower lobe areas are posterior, and the middle lobe on the right side is just in the axilla and in the mammary region. So if you remember that, then when we give a diagnosis, we'll be able to say, is it an upper lobe pathology, a middle lobe, or a lower lobe pathology? Now, how are breath sounds produced? Breath sounds go for inspiration and expiration. Inspiration is from nose to alveoli. Expiration is from alveoli to nose. That's a very basic principle that we must remember. Then what causes breath sounds? Turbulence causes breath sounds. Please understand that if you have a laminar flow, if the flow is quiet, then you do not hear breath sounds at all. That is why when you bring the third year student, the undergraduate to the class and ask him to auscultate anybody, he says he can't hear anything. It's not that he can't hear anything. It's because the patient breathing quietly, nothing you will hear. So if you want to hear breath sounds well, you do what is called augmented breathing. That means you ask the patient to do a good breath, take a good breath. And when he does a good breath, when he does like that, then you hear the breath sound. So turbulence is what causes sound. Like we say in cardiology, when the blood flows through the heart, blood is flowing through everybody's heart. Why are we not hearing murmurs? Because it's a laminar flow. Similarly, in respiratory system, when the quiet breathing occurs, it's a laminar flow. So you do not hear any great sounds. You do hear inspiration and expiration, but it's not very loud. Whenever there is turbulence, when you take a deep breath, then you hear a better breath sound. And that is why the turbulence is the reason why you hear breath sounds. So it's from inspiration, it's from nose to alveoli. Remember that always. Expiration is from alveoli back to nose. So that's what this diagram represents. So you can see that inspiration, vesicular breathing begins like that, goes up to the alveoli. This is the nose here to the alveoli and then back out through the nose. And we all know that the second part of expiration is silent. Now, why is it silent? It's not that air is not moving or you're not breathing or you're breathing to a 2:1 ratio, nothing like that. It's just that you're not hearing that part of expiration. That hearing is not there because it's a silent, it's passive flow of air. So inspiration is an active process. You decrease the intrathoracic pressure by expanding the chest and suck air in. So inspiration is an active process and it produces turbulence. So you hear it well. Whereas expiration is a passive collapse of the lung. So you don't hear it and the air is just meandering its way away. It's not getting forced out of the chest. So that's why expiration is not heard. It is passive because there is no turbulence of the air that comes out during expiration. Now that is why when you hear normal quiet breathing, inspiration is well heard, expiration is half heard, and the last half of expiration doesn't really reach the ear. Now, the typical description of the breathing, the vesicular breathing, is called rustling of leaves. Now, there's no way you can describe it when you listen to the air on the leaves or of a tree. The sound that you get, that is supposed to be the quality of the breathing. The quality is something like a tune. You can't describe a tune of an English song. You can't describe it in words. You simply have to listen to it. You have to get used to it. So similarly, vesicular breathing is something, though it's described as rustling of leaves, no description will be able to describe it. It's just that you auscultate it and get used to the sound and say, okay, this is vesicular. Now, what happens is when you come from the nose to the alveoli and from alveoli back to the nose, you remember you are putting the stethoscope on the chest wall. Now, the chest wall has the ribs, the muscles, and the skin, everything is there in the chest wall. And though the lung is inside and the air is going in and out of the lung, the chest wall dampens that sound. So you do not hear the high pitch sound, you hear the low pitch sound through the chest wall. It acts as a filter. So that is why the quality of the vesicular breathing is because the lung transmits the sound, but the sound comes through the chest wall. And that's why you hear that peculiar quality, what you call as vesicular breathing. Now, all of you know that there is an entity called bronchial breathing because you're all postgraduates. And what we hear over the trachea, the typical way of experiencing a bronchial breathing is to put it on the trachea there, ask the patient to breathe, you hear a sound, that is the bronchial breathing. That's really very different from the vesicular breathing. Now, what are the characteristics of the bronchial breathing? You have an inspiration, you have a gap, and then you have the expiration. Now, inspiration and expiration are equal here in a bronchial breathing. That is because it's not that there are these conditions. In these conditions, you do not have the passive flow of air. So that's why the expiration is heard. When we come to those conditions, we'll explain. And you have a gap that also will explain why it comes. And the quality of the respiration changes. Again, like what I told you, you may call it aspirate, you may call it guttural in quality. These are words. These do not substitute for understanding how the bronchial breathing sounds. So the best way for us to understand what is bronchial breathing is simply auscultate over the trachea, that's a bronchial breathing. Simply auscultate over the lungs, that's a vesicular breathing. That's the only best way to describe that. Now, out of these three things, which of these is the most important? Now, when you answer this question, think about it. Okay, fine. Now we are doing a normal vesicular breathing. You are inspiring, you are expiring, right? Now, I could do a normal breathing by inspiring and expiring to the equal extent. I can lengthen my expiration. For example, I can do, I can make it longer than inspiration if you want. So it's voluntary. You can really change the length of your expiration. For example, when you do pranayama, they tell you breathe out for a long time. Don't you do it? It's possible. So inspiration and expiration, though we say in normal vesicular breaths out, you do not hear the expiration. If you do a voluntary good expiration, you can hear it. So this inspiration expiration being different in a bronchial breathing, please understand that it can be changed by the individual. The individual can change the length of the expiration. So that is not completely reliable. Now the gap, I can produce a gap. I can do inspiration, hold, give the gap, and I can expire. So I can produce a gap. It's possible. So patients, sometimes when you give them instructions, they may not understand. So sometimes they may breathe like that for you. They may take a breath. They may give themselves a gap and then expire. So again, the gap can be voluntary. What cannot be changed by the patient is the quality of the breathing. Now, like I told you, again, it's impossible to describe the quality. The best way to describe is called aspirate in quality, as if it's being sucked, like doing like that. One kind of sound that you do as if you are aspirating that air. That's the best way to describe, but that is quite insufficient to understand what is a bronchial breathing. So understand what is bronchial breathing, simply auscultate one. Go to the trachea, auscultate to the trachea, that's where the bronchial breathing lies. But the theory characteristics of bronchial breathing as described in textbooks, and I will tell you as we go by, are that inspiration and expiration become equal. There is a gap between inspiration and expiration, and the quality of the respiration is different from the vesicular. It becomes aspirate or guttural in quality. And the most important of all this is the quality of breathing. Now, the third type of breathing that we call is bronchovesicular, where it looks like bronchial, but it is not bronchial. There is a vesicular element to it. It's a little high-pitched, more high-pitched than the vesicular. Now, this you can auscultate wherever you are going close to the trachea. For example, you know the trachea is here, intrathoracic trachea is there behind the manubrium sternum. So if you auscultate very close, okay? If you auscultate just next to the trachea front, this side, or in the back, in the scapular region, up to the carina, if you auscultate, you will get a breathing that looks a little more than vesicular, but not exactly bronchial, which is what you call as bronchovesicular breathing. It's also called puerile breathing. When you auscultate a child, okay, then you get these kind of breath sounds which look bronchovesicular. Again, it's a combination of both. Doesn't have a typical description as such, but it is somewhere in between. And in normal adults, you hear them when you auscultate close to the trachea. Now, if you look at the traditional cause of bronchial breathing, there are many, but generally we say consolidation, which is tubular, high-pitched, cavernous, which is due on a cavity, which is low pitch, and you have an amphoric, which is in a large cavity, or in an open pneumothorax, which means bronchopleural fistula is there, where you describe as low pitched with high pitched overtones. That is the description given for amphoric breathing. Now, these are the three most common causes of bronchial breathing: consolidation, tubular, high pitched, cavity, cavernous, low pitch. Very easy to remember because cavity is cavernous. C goes with C. That's how I treat the undergraduates. The amphoric is a different kind of breathing which occurs in a large cavity. Now, what is the mechanism of bronchial breathing? Let's go to the mechanism. Now, let's take consolidation. Why do we get a bronchial breathing in a consolidation? We say that inspiration is equal to expiration. Let's see what is happening in a consolidation. In a consolidation, you have a lung which becomes solid, isn't it? The consolidation means the lung becomes solid, and the solid portion of the lung, which is the alveoli, which is filled with your red hepatization, gray hepatization, etc., consolidation. Now, that is around an open bronchus. There is a bronchus there. For example, in the X-ray, you say, you get an air bronchogram. What is that air bronchogram? It's the bronchus which is leading into the consolidated portion of the lung. So imagine there is a bronchus coming here into this lung. That bronchus is open. Around that, you have a solid lung. Okay? A solid lung is sitting on an open bronchus, and your stethis is here. Now remember, solid conducts the sound very well. Okay? It's an excellent conductor of sound. So if you put here, what are you going to hear? You are going to hear the breath sound that is produced at the level of the bronchus. Okay, so that's what you're hearing. Okay, so you get a high-pitched bronchial breathing. Okay, it's like as if you took your stethoscope and put it inside and put it on the bronchus. If you put it on the bronchus, what would you hear? That's what you hear in a consolidation. Inspiration is equal to expiration because you are hearing the like a bronchus. On the bronchus, there is no alveoli there. So inspiration and expiration will be equal. Air will come in and go out with turbulence. Why is there a gap? Remember, the gap is a portion at the end of inspiration. Okay? At the end of inspiration, in consolidation, there is no alveoli. So what does the air do? Air goes and pauses at the level of that bronchus, keeps quiet, waits for the rest of the lung to complete the alveolar phase and comes back. Right? So that's why you're getting the pause. Here is the alveolus. This is where the alveolus should be. And in a consolidation, you're not having the alveolus. So that is why there is a gap in that breathing because there is no alveolar phase. So you got an inspiration equal to expiration. You got no alveolar phase. So there is a gap. The quality is that what you auscultate over a bronchus and heard as if the stethoscope is placed on the bronchus. Why is it? Because the solid lung conducts the bronchial sounds. So this is the reason why you get a bronchial breathing in a consolidation. And this is the reason why it is high-pitched. Is that clear? I go on to a cavity. In a bronchial breathing, in a cavity. Now again, in a cavity, inspiration becomes equal to expiration. Again, because the air comes with turbulence into that. Okay. There is a gap because remember the cavity has no alveolus. The cavity is a destroyed part of the lung. There is no alveolus in the cavity. So during that place where you should have got the alveolus, which is here. Remember, this is nose, this is nose, this is alveolus. So in that portion, there is no alveolus. So there is a gap and that's the alveolar phase. But the quality of the bronchial breathing in a cavity is a suction. Okay. There is a bronchus, there is a cavity. So air is coming through the bronchus into the cavity. So the cavity is a thin walled cavity. It opens up and sucks the air. So that is called aspirate quality or low pitched. And that is what is called a cavernous bronchial breath sound. Whereas in a consolidation, it's a high pitched tubular bronchial breath sound. But in both of them, you don't have an alveolar phase. So you get a gap and the quality of the breathing is different because it's not normal lung. It's not the vesicular component of the normal lung. There's nothing to dampen it. So that's why you get a different quality. Now, when is bronchial breathing not heard over a cavity? Now, please remember, you got a thick chest wall or an obese person or a cavity which is deep. Okay, it's really deep. You remember your stethoscope cannot auscultate anything that's beyond 5 centimeters. Beyond 5 centimeters inside, whatever is there, your stethoscope cannot pick up. So if it's a deep cavity, which is lying right inside the lung, then you would not hear it. It's not big enough. You need a certain size. You need at least a 3 centimeters size of the cavity to hear a bronchial breathing. The third reason, it is not connected to the bronchus. If the bronchus has to open into that cavity, if it doesn't open, then you will not hear. So remember that bronchial breathing auscultation for a cavity is not foolproof. Okay, because of these limitations that you have, sometimes you will not hear any bronchial breathing, but you take a chest x-ray, you're finding a cavity there. So chest x-ray can surprise you. And please remember that you need not always hear a bronchial breathing over a cavity if these characteristics are not there. Now come to the amphoric breathing. Amphoric breathing is either a bronchopleural fistula or an open pneumothorax, or also it can be over a bronchus, which is leading on to a big cavity. Okay, the bronchopleural fistula is nothing but a big cavity. There's a bronchus. Okay, it is opening into the pleural cavity, and it is like you put a pipe and opened it into the pleural cavity, which is a big cavity, right? So it's a bronchus which is opening into a large cavity. Again, you have inspiration which is equal to expiration because air goes with force into that bronchopleural fistula or into the large cavity. There is no alveolar phase. Remember the gap, the last part of inspiration is because of the alveoli. You do not have alveolus, you get a gap. The quality can be metallic in quality. In fact, it's very interesting. I don't know if you have heard an amphoric bronchial breathing. It's really exciting the first time you hear it because it's got one very nice metallic quality. Okay, you describe it as a low pitched sound with high pitched overtones, which are again, like I told you, words. You can mug it up, you can tell in the exam, but if you don't understand, you don't understand. That's all it is. It's the equivalent of blowing on top of a bottle. Okay, you take a glass bottle, hold it like that, and blow on the top. When you blow like that on the top, the sound that you get, that's amphoric. In villages, I remember we used to have one thing to light up the stoves, isn't it? My generation, when my grandmother's place, used to have the coal stove, okay, in which you have to put the firewood, and then you have a long metal pipe through which you blow, okay? And that's what the amphoric sound reminds me of. You get a high-pitched foo sound, okay? That's an amphoric sound. So the characteristic of the amphoric sound is that it is little metallic. It's a low-pitched sound with high-pitched overtones, but it is due to a bronchus leading into a large cavity. This large cavity can be a pleural cavity. That's when you get it over a bronchopleural fistula. Or it can get a big cavity in the lung and an open bronchus. When the patient takes a breath, you hear it. Okay, fine. So these are the classical three types of bronchial breathing: consolidation, cavity, and amphoric breathing. Tubular, cavernous, and amphoric, what we call it. And this is the explanation why we have a bronchial breathing in them. Now, can you get a bronchial breathing in a normal person? Yes, of course. Over the trachea, you can hear. And like I told you, voluntary augmented breathing. Sometimes when a patient is, you know, obese or thick-chested and you can't hear anything, we tell the patient, take a deep breath now. Now, what happens is when he takes a deep breath, it will sound bronchial to you. You must remember that, because he is producing turbulence. He is probably increasing his expiration. And if he so desires, he may produce a gap. So please understand, to hear a breath sound, yes, you can tell the patient. And in fact, always we tell the patient to do augmented breathing. But we must remember, when we do augmented breathing, we are changing the quality of the breath sound. You can try it on your friend. You can auscultate your friend, see the vesicular breathing, ask him to take a nice good breath, and you can change the quality, changing to something like a bronchial breathing. Now, in the exam, they ask you, what are the causes of bronchial breathing? You will say, okay, this consolidation, cavity, then this open pneumothorax, large cavity. And then there are so many other causes. One of them is peripheral collapse. That means there's a bronchus leading into a lung, but the rest of the lung is collapsed. Okay, that's a very, very rare thing. Generally, when we say collapse, we mean the main bronchus is obstructed, obstructive collapse. That's what we mean. A peripheral collapse is a very rare thing, like what you get in a bronchoalveolar carcinoma, where the alveoli are full of fluid, but the leading bronchus is patent. Okay, fine. Then you can get a bronchial breathing. The Ewart sign that you get in the pericardial effusion in the lower end of the scapula on the left side, that's called Ewart sign. Above the level of a pleural effusion, when the pleural effusion causes a compression collapse of the lung, just above that, because the lung is collapsed there, the lungs looks like a consolidation to you, and then you auscultate just above the level of pleural effusion, that's where you hear a bronchial breathing. Bronchiectasis, because it can give rise to cavitation, so you can hear it. Pulled trachea, which we always say when the trachea is pulled to one side because of fibrosis, and in massive fibrosis of the lung, like in silicosis, asbestosis, etc., you can get a bronchial breathing because of the bronchus being there and the solid lung, which is fibrotic, conducting the sound to you. So there are many causes of bronchial breathing, but all of them, the principle is the same. There is no alveolar phase, and there is a gap there. The quality of the respiration changes, and inspiration becomes equal to expiration. Now let's go on to the second thing that we look for when we look for a breath sound. We look for the intensity of breath sounds. Intensity of breath sounds is diminished in a pleural effusion, pneumothorax, collapse, mass, and emphysema. These are the causes of diminished breath sounds. So what does the intensity of the breath sounds depend upon? It depends upon the amount of air entering the lung, okay? If you have a lot of air entering the lung, then you would hear a good breath sound, and how much turbulence, okay? So suppose somebody is not getting enough air into the lung. For example, you have a patient with emphysema, okay? What is his tidal volume? Tidal volume is less because he's not taking in much air. Now that person is likely to have diminished intensity of breath sounds because the amount of breath sound entering him is less. Now the turbulence, like what I said, quiet breathing, inaudible. If you got a good breath, you get a turbulence, and then your intensity of breath sounds will increase. Now let's look at the mechanism of absent breath sounds. What is the mechanism of absent breath sounds in a pleural effusion and pneumothorax, which are your two common causes of diminished breath sounds? Okay, so that is the pleural effusion, that is the collapsed lung, and that is the stent which you are laying there. Okay, now we say that breath sounds are diminished here, and most students will tell you, why is the breath sound diminished? Because there is fluid there. A fluid, please remember, is a very good conductor of sound. It's a better conductor of sound than air. Okay, when you look at the conduction of sound by anything, the solid is the best conductor, the liquid is the next conductor, then only air. So even more than air, the solid and the liquid should conduct. So actually this pleural effusion, this one should be conducting the breath sound very good. So you should actually be hearing very good breath sound. Now why are you not hearing breath sound? That, and similarly, you look at pneumothorax, you got an air here, you got a collapsed lung. Okay, why are you not hearing breath sound? Air should conduct, isn't it? Air should conduct, air is a good conductor of sound. Now you're not hearing breath sound because there is no expanding lung under your stethoscope. There is no air entering and leaving the lung under your stethoscope. That's why you get diminished breath sounds. If you auscultate over the liver, for example, will you hear breath sound? No, because there is no air entering and leaving, isn't it? Similarly, here also, this is a collapsed lung. When the lung is collapsed or the lung is semi-collapsed, whatever, the breath sounds will diminish because you're not getting air in. Not because this fluid has nothing to do. This fluid will actually conduct the breath sound. This air will actually conduct the breath sound, isn't it? But the point is, you don't have an expanding lung. So whenever you hear a diminished breath sound, you put your stent there, you close your eyes, you think, you're not hearing a breath sound or the breath sound is diminished. There is no expanding lung under your stethoscope. That's what you have to remember, okay? The breath sound is produced by the entry and leaving of air. You're not hearing good breath sounds. There is no expanding lung there, or the lung expansion is poor. That's what it means. So that's the reason why you're not hearing good breath sounds over a pleural effusion or a pneumothorax. Similarly, over a collapse. Now look at this lung. It's completely collapsed. Trachea is on this side. There is no air here. And you go and auscultate here. When you auscultate here, air will enter this side. This side you'll get breath sound. This side you won't get breath sound because air is not entering that lung. So when you put your stent there and you don't hear a breath sound, remember, under your stent, there is no air entering that lung. It's a very simple principle in life. So whenever you don't hear breath sound, please remember that there is no lung there which is expanding under your stethoscope, whichever be that area. Okay, now some problems that I'm putting up. A 65-year-old patient with COPD emphysema presents with sudden onset of severe breathlessness. This is a problem that we commonly give. On examination, we hear reduced breath sounds on his left chest and an amphoric breathing in the left axilla. Now I'll show you the chest x-ray. Okay, now that is this patient, right? What will be his auscultatory findings in this patient? Now I gave you the history. The history is that he is COPD patient, emphysema. He has sudden onset breathlessness, severe breathlessness, reduced breath sounds on the left side and an amphoric breathing in the left axilla. So you can see the x-ray here, and I'm going to read the x-ray for you. There is definitely emphysema, isn't it? Definitely emphysema. You can count down up to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 spaces. Diaphragm is flat. Okay. The ribs look more horizontal. There is emphysema. So what will be the breath sound on this side? The breath sound on this side has to be diminished because there is emphysema. The amount of air entering and leaving the chest on that side is much less. Look at the other side. He complained of pain and then he went in for he complained of severe breathlessness, and you saw this lung in the left axilla. You got amphoric breathing here. Now, what has happened to this lung? There is a pneumothorax here. You can see that there is a pneumothorax here. So here you will get absent breath sound If it's an open pneumothorax, there's a bronchus communicating with the pneumothorax, you would probably get an amphoric breath sound. So this patient with that history and this X-ray will have diminished breath sounds bilaterally because of emphysema and absent breath sounds in the left chest because of the presence of the pneumothorax. Okay, you can see the chest tube here. There's a chest tube here. Okay, fine. That is the pneumothorax. The absent bronchovascular markings are there. And so this is explained. This side absent breath sounds is not because the air is not conducting. It's because the lung is collapsed. There is a collapsed lung here. At least this part of the lung is totally gone. Only a collapsed lung is there in the lower part. Okay, so the absent breath sounds is because of this collapsed lung. The diminished breath sounds of the emphysema is because of the poor tidal volume. The amount of air entering this emphysematous lung is less. That's why you're getting a diminished breath sounds. Now let's go on to crepitations. Okay, the adventitious sounds. Now adventitious sounds are crepitations and ronchi. What are the adventitious sounds due to? They are because of air bubbling through fluid. So if you bubble air through fluid wherever, then you would get adventitious breath sounds. So you get it in a bronchiectasis. You got bronchi and they're all having fluid and the secretions are there and the air is going in and out. So then you are hearing the breath sound because of the crepitation, because of the air going in and out of fluid filled air spaces. Okay. You can get adventitious sounds in pulmonary edema and ARDS. Okay. This could be different mechanisms. I'll explain why. In pulmonary edema and in ARDS, if you have a lot of pulmonary edema, gross pulmonary edema, then the pulmonary edema fills up the alveoli, it fills up the bronchus and the bronchioles, and there is fluid there, and then you bubble it through it. Okay. Similarly, in an ARDS also, if it is gross, you can get it. The second mechanism of crepitations is stiffened alveoli. Okay. Like you get in ILD, interstitial lung disease, like in ARDS, like in TB, where you get infiltrative tuberculosis in cavities and in pneumonia. We'll go through why you get crepitations in each of these. Okay. Now, the stiffened alveolar concept, I'll explain to you. Now, all of us, like I said, we are all taking air into the lungs. Okay. And we are expanding our alveoli. So, we are not hearing crepitations there, isn't it? We're not hearing crepitations. Normally, you don't hear any crepitation in anybody, but the alveoli is expanding. That is because it's a laminar flow. But if your alveoli is stiffened due to any condition, so you can get it stiffened because of an interstitial lung disease, you can get it stiffened because of an ARDS, because there's inflammation of the alveoli, so it is stiff. You can get it in tuberculosis, where there's infiltrative patchy tuberculosis. You can get it in tuberculous cavities, where there is secretion inside the cavity. You can get it in pneumonia, in early pneumonia, when the alveoli is becoming stiffened. Okay, so if you look at this, now let's see, this is the normal bronchus and the normal alveoli, this normal mucus there, air through the normal alveoli, there are no crepitations. Whereas when you get in bronchiectasis, you can see the mucus plug there, a damaged chest wall, air goes through this fluid. So if you have like a, you put a pipe into which you've got some fluid and you blow to it, through it, that's what you get in a bronchiectasis. Now the opening up of normal alveoli does not produce any sound, because it's laminar, okay? So you do not get any crepitations. But when you have stiffened alveoli and you blow air in, then you get crepitations. It is like what I like to always say, opening up a crumpled plastic cover, okay? You take any of the plastic covers that are there given to you in shops. Nowadays, I think they don't give you. So you take that out and put it on your mouth and blow into it. Then the plastic cover will open in a irregular way. It's not laminar flow. So the crinkles that you see here, they will all suddenly open up like that in bits and pieces. That is equal to the stiffened alveoli, and the crumpled thing opening up and giving that sound, that is the crepitation. Okay. So crepitations are because of two different mechanisms. One is if you put fluid through air, you'll get a crepitation, or if you open up a stiffened alveoli or a stiffened airway, the sudden opening up of that gives up a popping sound, which is your crepitation. So again, to come back to pulmonary edema, that is the healthy alveoli, that is the alveoli which is containing fluid, and when the pulmonary edema is gross, then you can get the sound that you get when you blow air through water, and that is pulmonary edema for you. Now, I'm just going to give a clinical context to it. Let's look at a case, okay? Now, you're standing in the casualty. You're called to see a 65-year-old patient with diabetes and ischemic heart disease in the emergency with breathlessness of 2 days duration, okay? 2 days he has had breathlessness. He's coming to you in the casualty. His saturation is maintained, but respiratory rate is high. He has fine Krebs in both bases, okay? What is the diagnosis? Now, he's a case of ischemic heart disease. He's a diabetic. He's likely to have heart failure. His saturation is maintained. Okay, he's not that hypoxic, but his respiratory rate is high, showing his work of breathing is going up. And he's got fine Krebs in both bases. Now, that is the beginning of a left heart failure. And the diagnosis would be a pulmonary edema. The beginning of a pulmonary edema. Now, his crepitations are because his alveoli are slowly filling up with little fluid and they are getting stiffened. And so these fine Krebs are because the alveoli are popping open like that because they are having a little fluid in them outside the in the interstitium and in the alveoli. So the fine Krebs will begin. And of course, they will begin in the base because that's where the fluid will accumulate. Now look at the next part. In 1 hour, he develops chest pain and sweating. Now if an ischemic heart disease patient develops chest pain and sweating, the diagnosis is obvious. He's going in for a myocardial infarction. He's now orthopneic, saturation drops to 85, extensive core scrubs in both lungs. What is the problem now? Now, this is a gross pulmonary edema, okay? Because now he has developed chest pain, sweating is there, is probably MI, orthopneic because the saturation dropped, he's becoming orthopneic, extensive crepitation. So what I want to emphasize is in pulmonary edema, both mechanisms can occur. In the initial part, when you got fine Krebs in the bases, that is not because too much fluid sitting there. That is because you got a stiff alveoli. The alveoli are getting stiffer because they are filled with fluid, small amount of fluid outside in the interstitial space and in the this thing, there you get fine Krebs. Now this you must have all seen. When you got a gross pulmonary edema, you can hear, and especially if the patient is dying, you hear the death rattle, where you get the fluid which is not only in the alveoli, but starts coming into the bronchus, bronchioles, things like that. And the air, the air is going through that fluid. So both mechanisms can come depending on which stage of pulmonary edema the person is in. Now, ARDS is a non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. So there's nothing so different than ARDS. So it will initially begin as a fine Krebs. Later on, you can get Krebs anywhere, okay? But in ARDS, of course, you don't go into the bronchus and all. So that is why your Krebs are maybe extensive, but they are usually fine to medium. Now let's go to another clinical case. Let's apply what we know. 55-year-old lady. ARDS, okay? Now, what would you think of? 3 months duration, lady is there, lot of sputum she's bringing out. Am I audible? Because my connection is staying unstable. Am I audible, Sanket?
Yes, ma'am, audible.
Okay, fine. So there are coarse Krebs in infrascapular areas. So if you have cough with purulent sputum, 3 months duration, long duration, infected sputum, coarse Krebs, that's a bronchiectasis, right? Look at the next problem. 55-year-old lady with ischemic heart disease presents with breathlessness, Krebs in the infrascapular areas. So what's happening here? Now this is ischemic heart disease, this is breathlessness, there is infrascapular area crepitations. So this is going to be towards a left heart failure. Now what's the difference between the two? In both of them, you're getting crepitations in the infrascapular areas. In bronchiectasis and in LV failure, you are getting Krebs in the infrascapular areas. But look at your patient, okay? Look at your patient. Your patient here is a lady who has got 3 months history, purulent sputum, coarse Krebs. She's not breathless. She's not breathless. Look at this patient. This patient has no history of any cough expectoration and all. This patient is an IHD. Breathlessness is there. So there must be an LV dysfunction and the Krebs are there. Now, these are not bronchiectasis Krebs. These are going to be pulmonary edema Krebs. So there is a difference, even though you're getting crepitation, same finding you can get, but you must remember that your patient and the history decides what is this crepitation due to. Okay, Let's look at the type of crepitations and their mechanism. Now, this is a very important concept. Let's listen in carefully. Now, you got coarse crepes, fine crepes. Coarse crepes are air through fluid and large airways. So in large airways, like in bronchiectasis, like in pulmonary edema, when it comes into the bronchus and bronchioles, that's when you'll get coarse crepes. Fine crepes are always at the level of the alveoli. The fine crepes are coming to you at the level of the alveoli. So you get in ARDS, you get in ILD, you get in parenchymal tuberculosis, you get it in a pneumonia. Okay, fine. So in all of them, you get fine crepes because the problem is at the alveoli. The Velcro crepes of ILD are also starting in the alveoli. Okay, they got a peculiar sound. That's why you call them as Velcro crepes. Now, the concept is here. The type of crepitations depends on the size of the airway. Fine crepes you'll get from the alveoli. Medium crepes you'll get little bigger bronchioles. The coarse crepes you'll get in the bigger bronchi and bronchioles, the fifth to ninth generation, what we call it. So this is the important thing, that the type of crepitations tells you from where it is coming. If it is fine, it is coming from the end of the respiratory system, that is coming from the alveoli. If it is medium, it is depending on the size of the airway. If it is coarse, it's coming from the larger airways. So again, the crepitations will tell you what is the site of disease if you understand how to interpret them. Now let's put another clinical case here. 25-year-old student, high-grade fever and cough, minimal expectoration of 2 days duration. Okay, 25-year-old student, high-grade fever and cough. High-grade fever, infection. Cough, respiratory infection. Minimal expectoration, not much is coming out of the alveoli or the bronchi. Okay, clinical findings, few crepes, fine crepes, right infraclavicular region. Fine crepes, alveoli. This is a problem at the alveoli. It's a respiratory infection which is beginning in the alveoli, probably coming from the right infraclavicular, right upper lobe. Isn't it? So much information we have just with three lines of whatever is given. She refuses treatment and doesn't take any drugs. The next day, fever increases. She has a bronchial breathing in the same region. Now, what has happened now? She began with a high-grade fever, cough, minimal expectoration, okay, few fine crepes. So it was beginning as a pneumonitis. Now she's got a bronchial breathing. The lung has gone in for a consolidation. She's admitted, given IV antibiotics over the next 2 to 4 days. Bronchial breathing disappears. Audible crepes appear. She begins to bring out yellow sputum. Now what is happening here? This is your consolidation phase. This is your phase where you get the gray hepatization, red hepatization, etc. This is your consolidation phase, okay? Because that's when you got your bronchial breathing. Then when you gave her the antibiotics, the consolidation is resolving. So the bronchial breathing will disappear. Audible crepes appear. Why? Because it's resolution. Resolution phase, the sputum will come out, okay? The secretions will resolve and they are coming out. Now these crepes are not fine because these crepes are sputum which is coming into the airways. Okay, so like we said, fine crepes begin in the alveoli. Very audible crepes, medium crepes are coming into the bronchi, bronchioles like that. She begins to bring in yellow sputum. Now you understand why you get these different findings in different stages of a pneumonia. The antibiotics only fast forwards the pneumonia. If you let people have a pneumonia and resolve on their own, which they can, which is what happened in the pre-antibiotic era, people did survive, isn't it? The pneumonia will last 1 to 2 weeks, patient will come out all right. He will go through all those phases, red hepatization, gray hepatization, consolidation, resolution. He will do it on his own, doesn't require an antibiotic. What the anti, or he may die, both are possible. Now, when you give antibiotic, this 1 to 2 weeks has become 3 days, 5 days. You are fast forwarding the whole pneumonia. The pneumonia will come and go very fast. Okay. Now this patient, I have particularly written, did not take treatment because I wanted her to go in for a consolidation. That's what you got here. And then with the antibiotic coming in, it resolved. So now you can understand the findings that came in this patient and what would be your interpretation if you saw her at this stage, if you saw her at the consolidation stage, or if you saw her at the resolution stage. Okay, now the next thing we must understand about crepitations, we told about What is the nature of crepitation? Fine, medium, or coarse? The second thing is the timing of the crepitations. Okay. Now, if it is end inspiratory, it is at the alveoli. Remember, the air comes to the alveoli at the end of inspiration. At the end of inspiration. So, if you're hearing a crepitation at the end of inspiration, it is at the level of the alveoli. So, the ILD, the conditions like ischemic, interstitial lung disease, the air enters the alveoli. So that is why end inspiratory crepitations or late inspiratory crepitations are features of ILD. Mid inspiratory is in bronchiectasis because it's the bigger airways, isn't it? And expiratory, again in bronchiectasis, because they are bigger bronchi, okay, they're bigger airways, the air is going in and out through fluid. So you will hear it in inspiration and expiration. Whereas in the alveoli, it will be only heard in inspiration. And that too, if it is at the level of the alveoli, it is late inspiratory or end inspiratory. So when we look at crepitations, we have to ask ourselves two questions. What is the nature of the crepitations? Is it fine, medium, or coarse? Okay, that tells you the space of origin. Where is it coming from? It tells you. You also ask yourself, what is the timing of the crepitations? Is it end inspiratory, mid inspiratory, or inspiratory and expiratory? That tells you again, where is it coming from? So if you understand crepitations, you can actually make a very easy diagnosis of where is the pathology, and then you can proceed to make an etiological diagnosis. Okay, going on to ronchi. Sanket, is my speed okay, or I'm fast or slow, or I'm all right?
Ma'am, it's all right, ma'am. It's all right, ma'am.
It's fine, ma'am. We understand.
Ma'am, you've muted your video. Your voice, ma'am.
Oh.
Okay, can you hear me?
Ma'am, Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. So we go on to ronchi. 55-year-old, again, I'm starting with a problem. 55-year-old patient with bronchial asthma brought to you with severe breathlessness. The resident at emergency records a saturation of 78 in a very breathless patient, but finds no audible wheeze. What is the diagnosis? That's a silent chest, isn't it? That's a silent chest. Why are we not hearing the wheeze? Because there's no airflow. To hear a wheezing, you must have airflow, isn't it? Air must go in and come out for you to hear anything. If you've got such a constricted airway that no air goes in and out, then you get what we call as a silent chest. Now remember, ronchi are adventitious sounds produced at the level of airways. It is produced at the level of airways. They are musical sounds. Again, all this music, whatever I'm telling, is only description. Unless you hear ronchi, you will not be able to understand. I think all of you have auscultated, so you know. So when we see a very breathless patient, saturation is low, patient had bronchial asthma earlier, and you're not hearing an audible wheeze, now don't go and make another diagnosis. It's probably a silent chest. You can see your patient using all accessory muscles, struggling to breathe, and then no wheezing. That is a silent chest. Look at what happens after that. After two nebulizations, patient feels somewhat better, but whistling sounds, ronchi, are audible in inspiration and expiration. Okay, fine. Generally, ronchi are, like I told you, they are due to the airways, and generally they will be heard during expiration because the airways become smaller during expiration. Please remember, when we take a good breath, the trachea, the bronchi, the bronchioles, everything expands. It's not that you're expanding only your lung, because the elastic recoil of the lung, the lung pulls the airway apart. Okay. So the diameter of the whole airways increases during inspiration and decreases during expiration. So if you have an obstruction, you're going to get it more during expiration. Okay. But when you have obstruction that is quite bad, then you can have ronchi during inspiration and expiration. Okay. Now, why did the sounds come back? You had a silent chest. It came back. That means, is the obstruction better? Yes, It is better because some air is entering, isn't it? Some air is going in and coming out. So we know that the ronchi mean that the breath sounds are getting better, the obstruction is getting better. What is the degree of obstruction now? Definitely less than this part. Definitely less than the silent chest part, because now you are hearing a breath sound. So from silent chest, you came to ronchi, which are heard during inspiration and expiration. Oh, my slide is not moving. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Voice is clearly audible.
Voice is clearly audible, but my slide is not moving. 1 minute.
Down left, is there any arrow?
Down left. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Now, after 2 days of intense bronchodilators, okay, resident feels the ronchi become audible, very audible. So you had this patient in emergency, then you kept in ICU, then you brought the patient out, and then you gave bronchodilators. Now, when you ask the resident, is the patient better? Actually, the resident will tell you patient is worse, because he can hear ronchi very well, okay? And now they are heard in expiration only. They were previously heard in inspiration and expiration, but they are heard in expiration only. But many times people mistake it, saying that, oh, the ronchi is very well heard. So actually the patient's obstruction is worse. Actually it is wrong. These ronchi are not because of more obstruction. Very audible means the bronchus is opening up and you're getting air in and out. So the ronchi will get louder. The patient is actually better. So go with the patient. When the patient is better, but you can hear the ronchi, doesn't matter. Follow the same rules. No accessory muscles are working. Patient is able to complete sentences, not hypoxic. Any amount of ronchi he has, he's still very happy with his ronchi. That means the ronchi are not so bad, right? So that means the patient is getting better. So he's not worsening. What is the degree of obstruction? The degree of obstruction is getting better. Now, what are the reasons why we say obstruction is getting better? Number one, the ronchi become very audible, okay? The second thing is, remember we had ronchi during inspiration and expiration. Now you are hearing them only in expiration, right? So look at how we changed. When the patient had very bad obstruction, patient is very breathless, using all accessory muscles, very hypoxic, struggling to breathe, no ronchi, silent chest. Gave few nebulizations, patient became better. You're hearing the ronchi, inspiration and expiration, but high-pitched whistling sound. Then you brought him to the ward. Patient is much better. Very loud ronchi. Everybody can hear. You can call the undergraduate and show ronchi. Okay? But the ronchi have become only in expiration. So this is how you follow up a patient with bronchial asthma for improvement. You look at two things. You look at whether it is heard during inspiration and expiration. Somebody who has during inspiration and expiration is worse off than somebody who has got only during expiration. And then the pitch of the ronchi, which I will explain to you. Now, sonorous ronchi are low pitch and less obstruction. You, again, the pitch is something that we cannot explain. The simple way of teaching pitch is a woman's voice. My voice is high pitched, whereas Sanket's voice is low pitched. A man's voice is low pitched. So sonorous ronchi are low pitch ronchi. They mean less obstruction. Sibilant ronchi are high pitch, whistling sound, whee sound. If you hear, that means that person has got bad obstruction, severe obstruction. So when the person becomes better, okay, you will get from sibilant ronchi, it will become sonorous, and then you will hear it from inspiration and expiration to only expiration, okay, and then the patient in many other ways is better. So that's how you follow up any patient with wheezing, with bronchial asthma, with COPD. That's what you're looking for when you auscultate for the ronchi. Now, a stridor is because of inspiratory obstruction, because of large airways. For example, if you have a patient with laryngeal edema, you got a tracheal foreign body, you got a mediastinal node compressing on trachea, that is when you will get a stridor. Expiratory obstruction, always remember, is coming from the smaller airways. And ronchi as such, you can hear from the airways. And like what I said, always expiration causes more obstruction. Ronchi are more likely to be heard during expiration. And one more small trick is, when you want to hear the ronchi, Okay, ask the patient to do augmented breathing. Ask the patient to take a deep breath and leave. Then you do nice, good breath. Then you're forcing the air through the bronchus. That time you'll hear the ronchi. So sometimes patient will be telling, I'm having wheezing. But when you auscultate quietly, you don't hear. You tell the patient to take a deep breath and leave. During that expiration, you will hear the ronchi. Okay, that's when you realize that this patient is actually wheezing. Okay, fine. So this is about the ronchi. Let's go on to another part of ronchi. Another clinical case, 60-year-old man, smoker, comes with weight loss of 5 kgs over 2 months, increased cough, mucopurulent sputum. Okay. On examination, ronchi are heard in the right infraclavicular region. Percussion note is dull, no mediastinal shift. Okay. Now, this itself is enough for you. You got a smoker, weight loss, 2 months, increased cough, you know, the change in cough that happens, mucopurulent sputum is there. So you get that. So you get a weight loss. This you are already thinking probably has got a bronchogenic carcinoma. And you're hearing ronchi in the infraclavicular area. Percussion note is dull. Percussion note is dull means there is solid under your percussing finger. Okay, so there's probably a mass and you got a ronchi which is heard only there. Okay, now this ronchi is localized to that infraclavicular area and this is what you will call as a monophonic ronchi. So ronchi can be classified as monophonic or polyphonic, local obstruction versus generalized. So the case that I gave you, the ronchi that you heard in the infraclavicular area, that is because of an obstructed bronchus in that area. That is called a monophonic wheeze, okay? And a polyphonic is, it's heard all over and multiple different kinds of ronchi you're hearing. So it is because of a fixed obstruction versus a variable obstruction. Whereas stridor, we said, is upper airway, and upper airway obstructions are inspiratory obstructions, whereas lower airway obstructions are expiratory obstructions. Now we go on to one more part. 45-year-old man presents with fever, right lower chest pain of 2 days duration. He has cough with minimal expectoration. Okay, so fever is there, right chest pain, cough with minimal sputum. Auscultation reveals a bronchial breathing in the right infrascapular area and there are adventitious sounds. Okay, now obviously this is a pneumonia, right? He's got a fever, he's got a right chest pain, he's got cough. Minimal expectoration. Fever is infection, cough is respiratory. Respiratory infection, chest pain is there, probably pleural involvement. He got a bronchial breathing, okay, fine, probably pneumonia. Adventitious sounds are there. Now the resident thinks they are Krebs, but the assistant thinks it's a rub, okay? Now because he can have, a pneumonia person can have, a pleural rub is present, about 30% of pneumonia, pleural rub is present. So this could be a crepitation, this could be a rub, isn't it? What is the simplest way to find out who is right? Ask the patient to cough. Okay, cough, when you cough, the crepitations will move. They will change in quality, whereas the rub will not change in quality. Now, this is a commonly asked question for you. How do you differentiate a pleural rub versus crepitations? Pleural rub is biphasic, inspiration and expiration. Crepes are usually confined to one phase of respiration, usually inspiration. No change in coughing, whereas this changes with coughing. This is superficial, scratchy, can be felt. Many times I've demonstrated to postgraduate also, you put your hand over the rub, you can hear the scratchy sound there, you can feel it. There is no, this one does not have that. Increase on pressure with stethoscope. So you put your, apply your stethoscope with pressure, the rub will increase. And where do you auscultate for the rub? Where the person is saying pain, you auscultate, that's where you hear. Whereas crepitations, there is no change in coughing, no change in pressure of stethoscope, there is no local pain. So the simplest thing that you ask is to ask the patient to cough and then see whether it's crepitations or rub. Now, post-tussive crepitations. Post-tussive crepitations can come in a cavity. Now, what is this post-tussive crepitations? You ask the patient to cough and then you auscultate again. Okay, then you get crepitations. That's called post-tussive crepitations. Usually, over a tuberculous cavity, when we see cavity, we can hear the post-tussive crepitations. They tell you that there is a cavity, because the fluid is moving inside the cavity, okay? Post-tussive suction is a definite feature of a tuberculous cavity. That is because the thin-walled cavity of tuberculosis will collapse. And then when you take a deep breath, then you hear the sucking sound that is called post-tussive suction, which is a sine qua non of a cavity, the distinguishing feature of a cavity. Now, some tips about auscultation. Where do you auscultate? For tuberculosis, remember tuberculosis usually involves epico-posterior portion of the upper lobe. So you are actually auscultating in the suprascapular area. That's where you auscultate for a tuberculosis involvement. Post-ossive crepitations are because of infiltrations, so you can get them there. So if you're in a crowded OPD, you're thinking tuberculosis, you don't know where it is, and you think that probably there's something in the right upper lobe or left upper lobe, then you quickly auscultate the suprascapular area. After the patient coughs, put your stent there and auscultate. Bronchiectasis bibasal, that we know. Pulmonary edema, beginning bibasal can go everywhere. Pleural rub, where the patient says pain, there you auscultate. Listen to the patient, ask him, where is the pain? There you auscultate quietly for a rub. Auscultation in the ICU is always a challenge, okay? Because again, you need the breath sound, isn't it? You need the turbulence to auscultate. So that is why when the patient is on ventilator and not much is happening, you may not hear much. When you ambu is when you're pushing the air with turbulence, and that's when you hear the breath sound. So many times you get the wrong intubation, right bronchus intubation, one side intubation, etc. When you want to see, or you want to see a tube lock or something, look for absent breath sounds on that side or no movement of chest. Many times you're always looking at the ventilator. Ventilator may not pick up, easier to do clinically. Look at both sides of the chest. They're moving or not. Is there any movement of the chest? And you auscultate for an absent breath sounds. In ARDS, in an ICU, the tachypnea comes first. The first sign of ARDS in anybody is the presence of tachypnea, respiratory rate going up. Please understand, respiratory rate can go up even in a fever. Don't misinterpret. But not much of fever, tachypnea comes in, you have to worry. Then you get the fine Krebs of an ARDS. Then you get the hypoxia, right? So you must remember that in an ICU, you've got a patient with multi-organ dysfunction, no ARDS. But you watch that patient, tachypnea is coming first, you know that you are in danger. Patient is not all right. Look for the Krebs there. Look for the basal Krebs of an ARDS. Then after that, hypoxia will come like one thunder only, okay? So that's the importance of auscultation in the ICU. I think I'll finish in the next 5-10 minutes. Vocal resonance. Now, vocal resonance is actually a very useful thing in auscultation. In auscultation, we are looking for vocal resonance. That means we ask the patient to do 1-1-1, and then you auscultate over the chest and you're hearing that sound, isn't it? You won't hear 1-1-1 because the sound is actually being produced at the larynx, and then it goes down the trachea through the bronchus and then heard of the chest, and the chest also dampens it. So you're hearing one unintelligible sound, which is the vocal resonance, okay? And then you compare the vocal resonance, right? Now, increased vocal resonance, we'll talk about that first, which is called bronchophony. The easiest way of understanding what is bronchophony is, when you're auscultating for the vocal resonance, close your eyes, okay? Listen to it. Think, where am I hearing this sound? If you think you're hearing the sound at the chest piece, that is normal. If you think you're hearing the sounds at the ear piece, it is abnormal, okay? Next time you want to auscultate for vocal resonance, put your stent, ask the patient to say 1-1-1, auscultate. You're hearing, you think the sound is coming from the chest piece, normal vocal resonance. You think the sound is being heard in the ear, it is an increased vocal resonance. That's called bronchophony, okay? That's how you differentiate. It's not even the loudness, it's where you're hearing it from. Then you get the egophony, where E is heard as A, okay? That is because of the filtering of the sounds that you get. And then you get what is called whispering pectoral key. When you whisper, you're not producing, the vocal cords are held tight. You're not producing sound at the vocal cords. When you ask anybody to whisper and then you auscultate over the chest, what you're hearing is a whispered sound, which is again, you can't make out what is whispering. But when you hear an increased vocal resonance, that area, you will hear a whispering pectoral key. Like when he says 1-1-1, that sound, that 1-1-1 is heard to you as a whisper. Okay, it's an extreme form of vocal resonance. Very much increased vocal resonance, you will get whispering pectoral key. Now, the simple way of remembering when you will get an vocal resonance increase is wherever you get bronchial breathing, vocal resonance will be increased. Wherever you get bronchial breathing, so you get increased vocal resonance in a consolidation, increased vocal resonance over a cavity, increased vocal resonance wherever you get amphoric breathing. Simple way of remembering, because the mechanism of the increased transmission is the same. Okay, fine. And wherever you get decreased breath sounds, okay, pleural effusion, pneumothorax, collapse, in all these conditions, your vocal resonance will be diminished. So wherever you get decreased breath sounds, you can't hear anything. Wherever you get bronchial breathing, there you will get increased vocal resonance. In fact, one of the tricks that we use as seniors, which we won't tell you, because like cooks, you know, we don't tell you the tricks that we use. What is the best way of making some recipe? It's like that. What we usually do is, we first auscultate for the vocal resonance. Wherever we think the vocal resonance is increased, there we stop, then ask the patient to breathe. There you will hear the bronchial breathing. So the easier way of picking up a bronchial breathing is to go for the vocal resonance first. Wherever it is increased, there you put your stethoscope and then you auscultate, then you hear the bronchial breathing. So you go reverse instead of putting bronchial breathing first and then vocal resonance later. Two other signs that are usually mentioned. One is Hammond sign, which is a scratchy sound that you hear in mediastinal emphysema. You can hear it in your ICUs. You auscultate in the middle of the chest, in the mediastinum, and then you hear the scratchy sound. It is even more sensitive than the chest X-ray. Chest X-ray may not show mediastinal emphysema, but Hammond sign is positive. It's very exciting to hear this when you see in patients in the ICU or even otherwise. Okay, suction splash, you all know, in a hydropneumothorax, it's like shaking a half-filled bottle. So you are shaking the patient who has got a hydropneumothorax. Where would you put your steth? You would put your steth at the interface between the fluid and the air. So wherever you think the pleural effusion is ending, you put your steth there, hold the shoulder of the patient and give a little shake to the patient. The pleural cavity fluid will shake like a bottle, half-filled bottle, and then you hear the succussion splash. So these are some of the other signs that we use in auscultation. I'm using the last 5 minutes to emphasize something that is very, very important. And those of you who are interested in chess will know what we call as the end game. Okay, so I want to finish with the end game of clinical sense. These are two patients that happened to me in the last 1 month, and postgraduates who worked with me saw this happening in front of our eyes. These two patients I want to present to you. 25-year-old lady was admitted with left leg DVT. She was diagnosed to have a pneumonia a month ago, and her fussy mother put her on bed rest. Okay. Actually, I forgot to say this patient was pregnant. So 25-year-old, 2 months pregnant lady, left limb DVT she had, diagnosed to have a pneumonia in an outside hospital a month ago. Mother was very fussy, put her on bed rest. So everybody said, the mother put her on bed rest, so she got one DVT. Her chest X-ray taken at the time of so-called pneumonia had a small patch in the right middle zone, which they showed me. They showed me one small patch. When questioned, she never had fever. For the so-called pneumonia, she never had any fever. But she had a right chest pain at that time. Right-sided chest pain she had, which continued till date. Till date, she had chest pain in the right axilla. Auscultation revealed query Krebs in the right axilla. Okay. Now, when we look back at this patient, somebody called her pneumonia without a fever. No fever at all. Somebody called her pneumonia. She had a pain in the chest. Okay, it was thought to be a pleural involvement of a pneumonia, and blamed the mother for putting her on bed rest and producing a DVT. This was not crepitations. This was a pleural rub. This patient had a left leg DVT, and this probably was a pulmonary embolism. We did not do a CT because the patient was pregnant. This patient had an APLA syndrome when we investigated her, and this pneumonia, which was diagnosed on the basis of a chest X-ray showing a small patch, was a wrong diagnosis because this patient probably had a pulmonary embolism at that time. So never forget the basics. There is no fever. Why would you think of a respiratory infection at all? There is no fever. Okay. And this DVT is not because the mother put her on bed rest. This DVT is because she's APLA. She got one pulmonary embolism. She got one DVT. Okay, fine. So this patient had an APLA syndrome. Second patient I want to present to you. Both happened within 15 days. A 65-year-old man was treated for pneumonia for 2 weeks in an outside hospital with piperazole and azithromycin with no improvement. His only complaint was pain right chest. Okay. Auscultation revealed a pleural rub and chest x-ray was normal. Okay. This patient again, pneumonia, treated outside 2 weeks, no improvement. His only complaint was pain chest, never had fever. Okay. Nobody talks to patient these days. That's why they don't know what the patient is having. Auscultation revealed a pleural rub. Chest x-ray was normal. Next step, we did a CTPA and it showed segmental pulmonary embolism. Patient was very thankful. For 2 weeks, he had been hospitalized, bombarded with antibiotics. Nothing improved. All he had was a pulmonary embolism. Gave him anticoagulation and he walked back very happy. Now, I want to emphasize these two cases to you because it happens in this age, in this time, even now. We are missing patients because we do not take a good history. We do not examine them correctly. We do not think why this should happen. The logical reasoning is not there. There is no substitute for a good history and examination and good clinical sense. I want to thank all of you. I think we had a fantastic time. I hope you all learned well, and learning must always be joyous and happy. I thank you all as an audience, and thanks Sanket for organizing this, because I love to tell you all these things and want to say a few words about Sanket. He was my student. He was the best outgoing student from his batch in Manipal, and a very sharp person and very, very sincere and good doctor. What I like about him is his emphasis, even after becoming a rheumatologist, on the clinical sense that he has. And I'm very happy that he's teaching you. I think you are very lucky to have him as your teacher. Thank you all. If there are any questions, I can take.
Yes, thank you, ma'am, for your words. And to all the students, I will just tell that if madam is your examiner, two tips I will give. Your finding should be very honest. And second, it should make some proper sense. Then it is completely fine. Like, no need to manipulate anything when madam is examiner. So whatever tips I keep giving during class, if madam is examiner, forget everything. go for your proper honest finding, because she is going to pick up that. Okay, so
I never penalize anybody on a missed finding. I never penalize. As long as you have a logic in place. I know in the exam hall is a very tense place. So I don't penalize for that. But I do penalize if you talk rubbish. I can't take it. Because you must have a logic in this thing. You must look for the right things. Whether you find it or not, you pick it up after the examiner says, there's absolutely no problem. But good medicine always begins with good history and examination. That's what we don't want you to miss.
If anyone has question, can ask, and few people have asked question me through WhatsApp also, so I'll be conveying. Yeah. But before that, if someone wants to ask, please, you can start.
Ma'am, I have a question, ma'am.
Yeah.
On the last two cases, you told because of pulmonary embolism, patient was having a pleuritic type of chest pain.
Yes.
And I didn't get to know why pulmonary embolism could cause a pleuritic type of chest pain, ma'am.
Yeah.
Or a consolidation there.
Yeah, I'll tell you. Pulmonary embolism can be small, medium, or large. The large pulmonary embolism is what is described to you as a saddle embolus, big embolus, patient coming with hypotension, RV, right axis, and then one collapse and things like that. That's a huge embolus, okay? Then you have the medium-sized embolus. The medium-sized embolus will go into the medium pulmonary arteries and produce a infarction in the lung, which is wedge-shaped. It is wedge-shaped. If you get an X-ray, you will find the typical wedge there. And then it involves the pleura and causes a hemorrhagic pleural effusion. That's the second type of pulmonary embolism. The third type of pulmonary embolism is a small pulmonary emboli, which presents a chronic pulmonary thromboembolism, which is one form of primary pulmonary hypertension. Okay. So the medium-sized embolus is what is producing a lung infarction and produces the pleural rub. And it will cause a shadow in the chest x-ray, which will look to you like a pneumonia. That is how patients are being misdiagnosed. Look to you like a pneumonia, and you think it's a pneumonia, right? And pneumonia can also have a pleural rub. Pulmonary embolism can also have a pleural rub. The absence of fever is what makes you think that it's a pulmonary embolism. And if you don't do your CTPA, you'll completely miss it.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, there's another second question in patients of severe pulmonary hypertension, what is the pathology of causing a ronchi or an additional breath sounds in patients with severe pulmonary hypertension? Because they don't give any history of bronchial asthma before, but patient presenting with severe pulmonary hypertension with a normal echo background, with normal left ventricular ejection fraction, and with high right ventricular pressure.
Yeah.
We hear ronchi in patients with severe pulmonary hypertension, ma'am.
No, we don't. We don't hear any ronchi in pulmonary hypertension at all. Okay? Because the lung is not involved. See, ronchi is a disease of airways. Pulmonary hypertension is a disease of pulmonary vasculature. Okay? So, you do not hear any ronchi. If you have got ronchi in that patient, he has got one more disease, which is involving airways, which has to be bronchial asthma, COPD, whatever, chronic bronchitis,
okay,
any other thing. But it's not because of pulmonary hypertension.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Afternoon, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I had a doubt. Ma'am, we've been like discussing that the reason why we don't hear breath sounds in pleural effusion is because of the change in the medium from air to fluid. That's why the sound doesn't travel with that speed. So what is the correct, best explanation? Whether it's a change in the media or it's the no expansion of lung underneath that?
Yeah. I've heard this, that there's a change in the media and it won't, this thing. I don't think that change in the media makes so much difference as the total absence of air entering. Okay. The change in the media is not a big contribution to the absence of breath sounds. The main contribution to the absence of breath sound is there is no expanding lung under your stethoscope. Simple. Isn't it? So, I mean, even if you change the media or don't change the media, if there is no air entering your lung, how will you hear a breath sound? And okay, if you have a pneumothorax, where is the change in medium? Yeah?
Yes.
So I don't find, I have heard this explanation. I don't find that convincing. To me, it is because your lung is not expanding there. Because the policy of breath sound is that breath sounds you hear when air enters and leaves the lung, full stop, isn't it? So you're not having air entering or leaving the lung, you don't get breath sound.
I had one more doubt.
Sure.
Ma'am, clinically, when a patient presents with the volume loss, either we suspect it to be fibrosis or a collapse. Yeah. So even the VFBR will be impaired or reduced in both the conditions. And sometimes in fibrosis, ma'am, we don't even hear the added sounds. So that time, what is the best way to differentiate between fibrosis and the collapse?
Okay. Both fibrosis and collapse will cause volume loss, right? They will cause a mediastinal shift, okay? They will cause local problems, right? Drooping, hollowing, structural features. This is not an auscultation. I'm telling you before that. An acute collapse will not cause structural changes. Okay, suppose you inhale a foreign body. Okay, you're eating in a hotel, you inhale one foreign body goes into your right bronchus, lung collapses. You will not get a droop immediately. You can't, isn't it? A structural change means chronicity, right? So one of the ways of differentiating an acute collapse from a fibrosis is an acute collapse will not cause structural change. In a chronic collapse, collapse happening over a period of time. For example, you've got a bronchus which is obstructed and then that is causing collapse. Okay, that can be same as fibrosis. But an acute collapse will not have structural change, number one. Second thing, look at your findings in a fibrosis and a collapse, okay? The next thing you do is to percuss, okay? Collapse, again, percussion also has very few principles. And you percuss, if you get dullness, there is solid or fluid under your finger. Right. So in a collapse, there is no air. So there's solid. Okay. There's no air. You're going to get a dull note. Your fibrosis, it depends on what kind of fibrosis. For example, you have got a tuberculous fibrosis. That fibrosis will be patchy. It is not some massive fibrosis. Some parts are, fibrous. Some parts are not fibrous. So some alveoli are there. Some fibrosis is there. You percuss over that. You don't get a dull note. You get an impaired resonance. Impaired note. That means it is between normal and dull. Okay. That is because tuberculous fibrosis has that pathology. If you ask, if you percuss over an asbestosis, silicosis, then your percussion out can be done. Fine. Go to auscultation. Auscultation in collapse, breath sounds are diminished. There is no adventitious sound. Because breath sounds are diminished, no air is entering that lung. Okay. No adventitious sounds, nothing there to produce adventitious sounds. Look at your fibrosis. When you auscultate over a fibrosis, breath sounds may be diminished. But again, like what I said, if it is patchy and if it is involving parenchyma, you will get crepitations. Crepitations are features of fibrosis. Similarly, if you have distorted bronchi coming through that fibrotic area, bronchi are, you know, distorted, pulled apart like that by the surrounding lung fibrosis, you will get a bronchial breathing. In a collapse, you don't get a bronchial breathing. Obstructive collapse, you're talking about, there is no bronchial breathing. There's only diminished breath sounds, no adventitious sounds. Whereas in fibrosis, you can get a bronchial breathing, you can get crepitations, right? Breath sounds can be diminished because less air is entering, fine, but not as absent like in a collapse. Is that okay? Whoever asked that question, is that okay?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
okay, ma'am. Fine.
Thank you.
Ma'am, as such, we have some 5-6 questions from WhatsApp.
Yeah.
You are from Manipal, so I think they are not asking directly. So I will just keep the question without mentioning their name.
Sure, sure. I'll ask you later. You tell me, okay? Then I'll catch them. No, don't worry. Go on.
Yes, yes. So first question is, when patient is on ventilator, through endotracheal tube turbulence will always be there. So bronchial breath sounds heard are easily, is it possible that, like that?
No, because, yes, because the ventilator, the difference between ventilation and normal breathing is ventilation is positive pressure, isn't it? This is negative pressure. You are pushing air into the lung with positive pressure on a ventilator. And yes, I agree with the questioner that the size of the endotracheal tube is much smaller than the trachea. Fine. But you're not hearing bronchial breathing everywhere. That doesn't happen, okay? Because the amount of volume that you're putting is not that much, okay? And when you auscultate, you'll hear vesicular breathing only. That will not change. That will not change and you'll not hear bronchial breathing everywhere. That doesn't happen, okay? What is this question about that? What will happen?
Is it something that bronchial breath sound will be easy with endotracheal tube because of that continuous turbulence?
No. In fact, like what I was telling, suppose you auscultate a person on a ventilator, when he's on the ventilator, you auscultate, you will hear breath sound, right? You remove the ventilator, put an ambu, okay, and push, you know, 800 ml of tidal volume into him. You hear the sounds much better, isn't it? So it's not that the turbulence is more with the ventilator. The turbulence is actually maximum with the ambu. That's why when you want to know whether the tube is in position, you're not connecting to ventilator, you're ambuing. Ambu and go for the left axilla where you think that that is the least advantage for the lung. That's where you auscultate to find out whether your tube is not gone into right bronchi on both sides. So that's where you auscultate. You auscultate left axilla with an ambu. The ambu produces turbulence because you're pushing it, squeezing the air into the trachea. So not that you'll hear bronchial breathing better on a ventilator. No, it doesn't happen. But the quality of breath sound will change slightly because you've got a narrower endotracheal tube and your ventilation is pushing with positive pressure. It will change slightly, but not enough to completely change your findings. No.
Yes, ma'am. So next is when you explain, ma'am, someone wants it to be a repeat thing.
Yeah.
But what is the relationship between the cough and how rubs and crabs changes with the coughing?
Right. So when you're coughing, okay, if you've got secretions, so one of the reasons why you get crepitations is secretions, for example, in a cavity, you got secretions, okay, and you're putting air through that, you're getting that sound of crepitations, okay. So when you're coughing, you're actually changing the secretions, right? So when the secretions move, the quality of the secretions will change. they may disappear. You will find many times, no, suppose even if you have some secretions in your throat, okay, and when the patient is breathing, you are hearing one gorogora sound there. You ask the patient to cough, then after that it is cleared, right? Like that, even in the lung, when you auscultate, crepitations are capable of changing because they are moving in the respiratory tract. Whereas when you have a pleural rub has nothing to do with the respiration at all. It's outside the lung. It is because of two pleural surfaces which are rubbing each other. It will increase when you ask the patient to take a deep breath, which usually he will not do because he'll get more pain. That's why patients actually breathe less when they have a pleural rub, because it pains. Okay, fine. So they are outside the lung. So they will not change. When you cough, they will not change. Because crepitations are produced inside the lung. Okay. When you cough, you either move them or the alveoli are changing. Okay. Little stiffness is less, more, whatever. So that's why they will change their quality and the amount when you cough. But as a pleural rub, will never change.
Ma'am, there is one more question, which is like, I'm not sure clinically how it is relevant, but for exam, some people are bothered about it. Okay. That letter edition of McLeod and Hutchinson used the word crackles rather than crepitation.
Okay.
Further, it says not to stress upon fine or coarse things.
Yeah.
So in exam, we should still say crepes, or should we say crackles, or should we tell fine, coarse? Is it required? I'm not sure, but like it all matches with history as per my thing. Okay, when your history and things are correct, then things are almost solved. But exam, definitely it matters.
I understand the exam fear. But I think you should be a little more kind to your examiners. I don't think an examiner is going to penalize you because you called crackles as crepitations. That much intelligence I think they will have, isn't it? I don't think they will say that he called it crackles, so he should fail. That will not happen, okay? So each book says it in a different way. Regarding the second point, that's important. He said whether fine or coarse, you should not emphasize. Okay, that I will not agree. Even if McLeod says, I will not agree, because there is something called fine crepitations. You do get it in the early stages of a consolidation, when you're auscultating a TB infiltrates. Okay, you do get, and in the early pulmonary edema, you do get fine crepitations. And they are different from the crepitations of bronchiectasis. Okay, to me, it has been very useful. Okay, when I auscultate, I close my eyes and think, is this fine, medium or coarse? And that's how I decide where it is coming from. Okay, so I try to fit it in with the rest of the pathology. So I would say that, yes, in the exam, yes, we can say fine, coarse, medium. No, but McLeod is not your examiner. Okay, so don't worry about him now. Most of us will accept this terminology of fine, medium, coarse. That is fine. But apart from the exam, I find it useful. That's my opinion. Okay.
Yes, sir. One more question for last two cases.
Yeah.
How the ECG of those two clinical cases discussed in the end was? Also, if they had any other clinical finding like hypoxia, tachycardia, that kind of thing for those two cases from last.
Yes. I'll tell you. So both the cases were not hypoxic. Both were not tachypneic. This is because we think that everybody must have hypoxia, everybody has tachypnea, because we are imagining big pulmonary embolisms. Please understand that many pulmonary emboli are medium-sized and they call small infarctions in the lung. And remember, you will not get hypoxia if more than 50% of your lung is working. Isn't it? This, I think my KMC students will know that this dictum, that you can survive on one lung, okay, without hypoxia. So that means if you want to become hypoxic, 50% of your lung is not working, or you have a very high work of breathing. These are the only two reasons why you would get dyspneic or tachypneic or whatever, okay, or hypoxic, right? So both the patients were not hypoxic. Both were not tachypneic, okay? They were comfortable. Both of them were sitting and talking to me nicely. The lady was pregnant, so she had little tachycardia. The man was not pregnant, nothing. So he had no tachycardia, no fever, nothing was wrong with him. And ECG did not show anything. Now, your S1, Q3, T3 is a rare finding. It's a rare finding. It's not a common finding. S1, Q3, T3 is a typical finding, but present only in 10 to 20% of cases. The commonest ECG abnormality in pulmonary thromboembolism is tachycardia. Sinus tachycardia is the commonest ECG abnormality in the pulmonary embolism. But my two patients did not have even that because they had very small emboli. they did not have big emboli, so they did not have a problem with that also. So both the patients had normal ECG. The lady, we could not do an X-ray. The man, we did an X-ray. He showed some vague shadow, which was called pneumonia earlier on. But the CT scan showed fantastic pulmonary embolism. Very clear.
So I think, ma'am, at the end of the day, it states that if there is a problem unsolved, we have to get an answer. Then only things will be easy in medicine.
You have to at least recognize that something is not fitting.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
That's important.
Yeah.
To understand that something is not all right. You must get that sense. Only then you can progress. Okay?
So now, any other question from the live audience they want to ask, madam?
Yes. Ma'am, how to differentiate between right upper lobe consolidation bronchial breathing versus pull tracheostomy?
Okay. Right upper lobe consolidation will not cause shift of trachea.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Isn't it? In a pull trachea, your trachea is already pulled. Then
yes.
only you will get a pull trachea, right?
Yes.
So pull trachea is a feature of a volume loss. Okay. So the trachea moves to one side. There is drooping, there is hollowing, etc., etc. Okay. And the trachea visibly is on this side. So you auscultate there you get a bronchial breathing. That's a pull trachea. In the right upper lobe consolidation, the trachea is central. You got a dull note on percussion. And then, of course, you're hearing the bronchial breathing, etc. But again, I would ask you, what is the history? Isn't it? A right upper lobe consolidation man comes to you with a history of fever, cough, expectoration, etc., etc. Short duration. Your pull trachea man is going to come to you with, you know, long duration or tuberculosis, whatever, old current, whatever. Okay. So it's not at all difficult to differentiate these two. But one of the things that I was taught by a cardiothoracic surgeon, whom I really think was a great person, and Dr. Shatpathy, who taught respiratory system to me. And I think I'm surviving 30 years on what he taught me. He used to tell me that if you have a bronchial breathing, okay, you don't know this consolidation or a cavity or whatever, what you do is you percuss. Okay, if you get a dull note, it's a consolidation. If you don't get a dull note, it's either cavity, fibrosis, or whatever. Okay, that's not that's in this context what you're asking. Suppose you have a right upper lobe consolidation, you get a bronchial breathing, you percuss, it's a dull note, there is solid under your finger. Solid or fluid under your finger. Okay. Always translate pathology into clinical science. It's easy.
I asked an incomplete question. Sorry. Actually, it is a post-TB sequelae patient. Actually, he comes with a history of past tuberculosis.
Okay.
Now, whether he has pull trachea syndrome or when we ask for it, we get bronchial breathing in the right infraclavicular region.
Right.
Now we are confused whether he is having a secondary tubercular means reactivation of TB consolidation or whether it is the pull trachea.
Ask his history, no?
Means he has post-TB situation, ma'am, but no fever, no complaints of fever.
If he doesn't have fever, he doesn't have a consolidation.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Okay.
So always start from the history. Okay. Always start from the history. Then go to examination. Things will be clearer.
Okay. Okay.
And I think for exam also, when you are asked simple differences between these two conditions, don't go to your examination part first. Start with your history presentation.
Yes.
Even general examination findings are very important. That will clear
yes.
the thing.
Correct.
Then go to this. So mostly sometimes you should not go even there. They'll be knowing that you are thorough with this thing.
Yeah.
So sometimes if you are not knowing, just go there first. More clinical, more history. That makes you a better student
yes.
there in exam.
You can always say patient does not have fever, he's not toxic. Okay. You begin like that, then you are vetoing a pneumonia right away.
Yeah. Ma'am, one more question. That is a brief highlight on general examination finding important with respiratory finding that will help in the differential diagnosis. Mostly they will ask how general examination helps you in case of respiratory major case in exam. That kind of question, I think it is there.
Yeah, yeah. Now that is something that it's actually a bigger topic, but
yes.
general examination, you do anemia, cyanosis, clubbing, lymph node, edema, etc. Okay. Now, anemia in a respiratory system is uncommon. You generally expect polycythemia in a chronic respiratory illness. You're not looking for anemia. If anemia is there, it is wrong. Something is wrong. Your patient is losing blood from somewhere or some other reason is there for the anemia. Jaundice in a respiratory system, you don't really get unless you have a right heart failure or you have a pulmonary embolism, which is causing a hemolytic jaundice, or you have a mycoplasma pneumonia, which is causing a cold agglutinin hemolytic jaundice. Lymph node you look for when you look for bronchogenic carcinoma or a disseminated tuberculosis, etc. Okay, or a retrovirus infection causing, you know, some respiratory problem like that. Clubbing is something that's really linked to the respiratory system. So you know your undergraduate causes of clubbing: bronchogenic carcinoma, bronchiectasis, you know, the usual ones, empyema, things like that, and you get grade 4 clubbing, you know, hypertrophic pulmonary osteoarthropathy, usually in a bronchogenic carcinoma, usually felt in the periosteal thickening of the at the wrist. Okay, those are your usual causes of clubbing. ILD, of course, will qualify as a cause of clubbing. Cyanosis is important. Cyanosis always means hypoxia. And when you get a type 1 respiratory failure or a type 2 respiratory failure, that's when you get a cyanosis. A cyanosis plus clubbing in a respiratory system will always mean an ILD. To go towards an ILD, but that's your commonest cause. Okay, whereas cyanosis with a clubbing in a cardiovascular system will be a congenital heart disease. Okay, that's where it will go. Pedal edema will mean right heart failure, or sometimes patient is, you know, losing a lot of sputum, you know, and becomes very hypoalbuminemic. That's when you get a pedal edema. That's a rough listing right. Of all the conditions that you have.
And even I think to the person who has asked question, you can even have your 4 or 5 prototype diagnosis in each system, and where the general examination helps you that way.
Yes.
In cardiology, especially infective endocarditis, rheumatic heart disease.
Yeah.
Like acute. So those kind of things, if you have a list from head to toe, that will definitely help you in exam to tell. If in TB, they always ask what are the extra pulmonary finding of tuberculosis. So you should have a list, bronchogenic carcinoma, starting from clubbing to Pankow syndrome, it should be ready with you. Then it will be very easy to convince your examiner, okay, I am expecting this etiology. And along with this, these are the possible general examination findings. So that also can be a good approach to go there.
No, because you must understand, I think you all won't know the mind of an examiner. See, we have to ask questions to some 8 fellows, okay? And you have to ask different questions. You can't ask the same question. So what happens is, after you finish the standard ones, then you start asking slightly cranky ones. So you start asking, okay, general examination, what if this patient had jaundice? Like that it will start, which is going away from that topic, because many times we feel that the candidate may know the diagnosis or might have seen patients like this. Generally want to know the grasp of medicine in general. That's when these questions are asked. What if this patient had clubbing? What would you have thought of? Okay, now pleural effusion patient is there. If you had clubbing, you would have thought it's an empyema, right? Like that. So you go little outside there because you want to know whether the person has applied knowledge or not. Okay, these are standard questions. What you asked about general examination in respiratory system, general examination in cardiovascular system, these are all standard questions. And these you'll have to, these will not be given in any textbook. These you have to make your own list.
Ma'am, if it's permitted, one last question, I will go.
Sure.
Difference between right upper lobe cavity and pulled trachea.
Yeah. So difference, that is actually the more exam question, no? Because you have patient with tuberculosis who has got a pulled trachea or that is only fibrosis, or there is a cavity also, okay? Two things are told. One is that the pulled trachea causes a bronchial breathing only in the infraclavicular area. Don't go beyond that. Okay. So if you're hearing the bronchial breathing in the axilla also, then it means there is a cavity. Okay. Number one. Okay. Number two is, the typical feature of a cavity is postessive suction. Postessive crepitations can come in infiltration also. Postessive suction. So after he coughs, the next breath that he takes, if it has a sucking quality, then you call it as postessive suction. That is definite of a cavity, which is thin-walled and capable of collapsing and expanding. Only when it collapses and expands does it suck. Okay. So two findings that will favor the presence of a cavity are that the bronchial breathing is not only heard in the infratracheal area, but also heard in the axilla. Second thing, there is a post-tussive suction. If you don't have this, but you have only a fibrosis and a bronchial breathing, which is heard in only in the infraclavicular area, then you can say this is probably because of full trachea.
I think that clarifies very properly.
Yeah.
So I think, ma'am, you are the youngest physician among us. We all had in between one video of break and we had water. Yeah. Yeah. So okay. We always get inspired with your teaching and all. Thank you.
Thank you.